Seems crazy. I'm going to be squinting at everybody tonight, just so you know. So, we learned a lot last week as well, but we'll talk about that in a second. We're going to get right to it. So the agenda for tonight, we have a Vail CPA, as you can tell. Everyone has something in front of them there. That's going to be talking to us tonight about financials. We're going to have a quick break, and then we're going to be joined with Avison Young, where they're going to talk about location planning, which is a really interesting thing to consider whenever you're doing a business. And then we're going to have a quick conclusion. So, par for the course. So, before we go any further, I just say it as one for me one time.
March 29th.
Oh, come on, guys. As one, March 29th at 2 p.m. Don't be late. We're only halfway there. I'll forgive you guys being a little bit slow. But let's talk about last week. We have a familiar face. Who did their homework from last week?
I did, actually.
Oh, good. Good girl.
Who else? Anybody else?
Seriously?
Yeah?
Really?
I really didn't want to track my time.
You know, you want me to be your coach? You're going to do laps.
Yeah, I know. I didn't call you this week.
They never call when they don't do the homework.
That tells me a lot, though. Who did the homework?
People, what was the homework? Because you couldn't answer that this morning.
I couldn't answer. It was early in the morning at 7 o'clock.
Do you know what the homework was now?
Yeah, you had to do a...
It's a little late, though.
Now it's late.
Org chart.
Org chart. A positional contract or/slash job description. And time audit on yourself for 2 weeks. So I don't care about that one so much right now.
So some people did, some people didn't. There is some use, obviously, out of doing there's a reason that we bring in people like Garth to talk to you. He doesn't just pull this stuff out of nowhere. There's a reason they're so knowledgeable. How many books a week do you read?
Just one
book a week. I like, even with an audio book, finish it, you know, at 1.5 times speed.
So, can I be your coach for 2 seconds? Any book that's over an inch thick is probably got way too much information in it. So it should be about 3/4 of an inch and you'll blast through it. It's good information, you'll sink in. If it's over an inch, it's way too much information.
Good to know.
That's what a coach told me. So I only make sure I read small books.
Fantastic. So we talked about that. We talked about systems and how important they are to build. Anyone that's built a big, successful business, and especially, it's funny, because I get people in the franchise, and they say, what do I have to do? And when they talk to a franchise lawyer, the first thing they say is, well, what do your systems look like? It's something that every business needs to have, regardless of what your goals are. What about market research? What did you guys think of market research? Any takeaways?
I did a small survey on Facebook.
No way. How'd it go?
It went really well.
Fantastic.
I just asked my friends.
Hey, that's a start, right? And that's primary research. If it's your demographic, then that's how many other people did primary research this week? Fantastic. So we had 2 people, 3 people that went out, 4 people. So a few of you went out and actually used what you learned last week. Positive results, hopefully?
Yeah.
Oh, that's always a good thing. Probably wouldn't say anything if it wasn't positive results. Market research. That's a lot of, when people come to meet me and I tell them, well, you have a few hours of research ahead of you, they don't like to hear that. But the information's out there. How many heard the big news from the Stats Can release from the census that was done last year? About Lethbridge?
Yeah.
What did it say? They got 9,000. Is that
right? I was talking about that they were, what was it, fifth? I think it was, in terms of medium-sized cities in Canada. They were rated fifth in terms of growth. 10.1%.
But that's also bringing in other, like Coaldale, Coalhurst, and that type of community.
Yeah, they bring in the Lethbridge area. But it just goes to show that, that's the kind of thing that if you put in a business plan and say over the past 5 years, Lethbridge was... And for those of you that are in Lethbridge, but for those of you that aren't, go and check out the census online for what it says for your area. But those are the types of things that are important to know, and it's economic indicators. That's for any business. Economic indicators are going to be important for you to use. And there's a universal one. Housing starts are one of the biggest leading indicators that's out there that investors use, economists use. Go out and do the research, and you can put a ton of that information in for market research. The work's done. But without further ado, we're not talking about market research. This is obviously my last week's presentation. We're going to be talking about financials. So we have with us tonight Chandra from Avail CPA, who I think his been to more CEC years than I have. She's been able to come out and talk to you guys about financials. And they're the part that all of you, it doesn't matter what business you're in, what it is that you're doing, all of you are going to have financials. And this is one of those things where for you to know, at least on a basic level, what those are, how to interpret them, what they mean, is so important. Because you can get any number, as you're going to see tonight, there's so much information that you can glean from that. And most people that are going to look at your business plan, I know so many people that are, you know, whether they be investors, bankers, people that look at business plans, the first thing they do is flip to the very back and they look at the cash flow and they look at the balance sheet before they even bother with the competition and what you're selling. So it's really important stuff to know. And so without further ado, because as you guys know, I like to let my speakers speak for themselves, let's get a round of applause for Chandra.
Knowledge is incredibly important, and I am fully aware that it is not everyone's favorite topic, and a lot of people find it unexciting and a little bit dry, but I can't overstate how important it is and what you can get from the financial information.
You might have to hit the keyboard over that arrow, yeah.
So today I'm going to talk about understanding your financials. So as Jason mentioned, my name is Chandra Doe. I'm a CPA CA, and I'm a new partner with Avail CPA. So I've been with Avail for 12 years, and just moved into a new role. So the topics I'm going to cover today are bookkeeping, financial statements, ratio analysis, budgeting, and profit improvement. So the average business owner, and this is from my experience, this is the average person who owns a business. They're very knowledgeable about their industry. A lot of times they start a business, they're like, you know what, I'm an awesome plumber. Why am I working for somebody? I can be doing this myself. So they are great at what they do. They're very active, especially initially on the business side of things. So they're usually the ones out making sales or out doing the work or buying the product and selling it. So they're very active. And they're usually very good at what they do. But a lot of them have troubles with the number side. A lot of them are struggling with growth, and sometimes that's because they're not growing fast enough, so they're struggling because they can't seem to get things off the ground. And then on the other hand, we see people who are struggling with rapid growth. So things pick up and they can't keep up. They don't have the systems in place. They don't have the cash flow to sort of fund. You know, if you're selling something, you need to be able to buy that product before you can sell it to your end user, and that requires cash up front, which a lot of new business owners don't have. And then a lot of times they just make decisions based on their gut reaction. So what do I think I should do? And then they go ahead and do it. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. So with financial reporting, it's not just your annual statements. There's interim reporting, so that requires timely bookkeeping. It helps you identify problem areas early so you can correct what you're doing so that you don't get to the end of the year and realize, oh my gosh, I had a horrible year, I lost a lot of money, what happened? Then you do have your annual statements. So as soon as you start a business, and especially if you incorporate, you are required to have a balance sheet and income statement. Cash flow statement isn't required, but it's important, and I think it gives you a lot of really useful information. So I would encourage you to have a cash flow statement prepared. And then ratio analysis is something that from your financial reporting, from your financial statement, you can kind of look and see how things are going. And part of that is benchmarking, so know where you started and then see how things are going. Are they improving? Are they declining? And then also knowing your industry benchmark. So what are those ratios for your industry, and where are you in relation to that? Are you above average or below average? And then knowing your key performance indicators. So a lot of these will be ratios, but some of them are not financial. But basically, what 3 to 5 things do you have to get right to succeed? And that's what your KPIs will be. So why do you care? As I mentioned before, financial information makes gives you an ability to make better decisions. You can make more timely decisions if you have your financial records up to date. It can help you improve your bottom line, help you grow your business. It increases your credibility with banks. If you don't have a set of financial statements and you're trying to get financing from a bank, it's going to be incredibly tough. They want to see those financial statements. And then decreased interest and penalties. So this is, when I talk about that, I'm mostly talking about CRA interest and penalties. When are your filing deadlines? Do you have to file quarterly for GST? Are you doing payroll? What's your, and to know those filing deadlines and keep on top of your financials means that you're not paying unnecessary interest and penalties. So interim reporting starts with bookkeeping. And so I have some general considerations that you should think about when you're thinking, how am I going to keep my records? So what method will we use? Am I going to use an Excel spreadsheet? Am I going to use QuickBooks? Am I going to use Sage, which used to be called Simply Accounting? So how am I going to do it? And then who will do it? Am I going to try and do it myself? Am I going to try and hire somebody else to do it? Is the person I'm going to have do it? Are they capable? I see a lot of times with new businesses, the owner will sort of volunteer their spouse to do it. Well, that's fine if your spouse has the capability to do it and the desire to do it, but a lot of times what I see is that they don't. So they procrastinate and then they don't do a very good job, and by the time we get it, we're doing a lot of cleanup. Do they have the time available to keep things up to date? So if you're doing it yourself and you're trying to start a new business, do you really have time to also be keeping your books up to date? And then doing it yourself does not necessarily equal cost savings. So when you're starting up a new business, it's easy to think, well, I'm just going to do it myself because money is tight and I don't have a lot of extra cash. But if you don't do a good job, you're just going to be paying your accountant to redo it at the end of the year. So in that case, if you don't think that you're really interested in doing it, you don't think you have the capability of doing it, it's really a good idea to maybe think, should I do this externally? But when you do that, what I recommend is really interview who you're thinking about hiring as a bookkeeper. I see a lot of people who cost compare and think of it as a quantity. Like, well, this person's bookkeeping must be the same as this person's bookkeeping and the same as this person's. But there's a really big difference. So yes, you can probably find somebody that's $20 an hour versus 50 or 70. But a lot of times they're $20 an hour because they're not as experienced, they're maybe not as able to do it. So really, really interview them, find out what their qualifications are, what their experience is, and make sure that you're comfortable with them. Because, they're dealing with your financial records, and if you're looking at information that's not correct, you're not going to be getting the right answers from it. So your financial statements are there's really three main financial statements. So the first one is the balance sheet. So this is a snapshot of your financial health at a particular moment in time. So a lot of times you see year-end balance sheets, but you can pull a balance sheet for any day as long as your books are up to date. So the basic formula is your assets equal your liabilities plus your shareholder equity. And there was a national survey, and this was a U.S. national survey, that said that only 25% of small business owners can read their balance sheet. So that means 75% of business owners look at their balance sheet and have no idea what they're looking at. And so what I'm hoping is that I can kind of teach you what it's telling you. So your assets is what your company owns. Your liabilities is what your company owes. And your shareholders' equity is the amount that you have invested in your company. And it gives you a really, really rough idea of what your company's value is. And I say really rough because if you have things like land or other things that have appreciated in value, it won't pick that up. Or if you have goodwill or those kind of things. But it does give you a rough idea of what your company is worth. So this is an example of what a balance sheet looks like. So you've got your assets on the top, your liabilities and shareholder equity underneath. It's a balance sheet because it balances, so your assets equal your liabilities and equity. Some things to note with this is it's always going to be sorted. It's going to be split into current and long term. So this top part is current, this bottom part's the longer term. Same with your liabilities, current, long term. and it's going to be sorted by liquidity. So how fast can you convert those items to cash, or how fast do they need to be paid out in cash? So cash is obviously top because you don't have to convert cash, it just is cash. Marketable securities, if you call your investment advisor, you can have cash today. Accounts receivable is next. So that's further down because it takes time. You have to get your clients to pay. Presumably you're going to collect that. So the current, what classifies as current is, are you going to collect it within the next year, basically? So hopefully all of your accounts receivables will be collected sooner than in the next year, hopefully in the next 30 days. Then work in progress. So this is jobs that you have started. It's essentially an inventory classification. So I've started a job, it hasn't changed hands, this is what I've invested in it so far. And then your inventory, what are you holding in your inventory? And those are lower on the list because it takes time to sell that inventory and to finish that work in progress.
With my business, much of our items are on consignment. So it's not really our inventory, so I wouldn't count that in at all.
No, because you don't technically own the item. You're performing a service for somebody and then collecting it. So you're right, you wouldn't have any inventory in your system. Then capital assets are things you own that are expected to last for a long time. These are land, building, equipment, vehicles, office furniture, anything like that that you're gonna own for quite a while. And then you got your total assets. And then under that, then you start with your liabilities. So accounts payable are at the top because presumably you have to pay those payables within 30 days. You've got your other payables, so these are all CRA remittances. Deferred revenue is money that you have collected but you haven't earned yet. So if you collect, say you're a photographer and you're doing a wedding in the summer and your deposit is $5,000 to reserve your spot, you haven't earned that money until you've done that job. So it's gonna sit on your balance sheet as a liability, because until you perform that work, you still owe that person that money. And then your current portion of long-term debt. So that's important because it breaks out, this is what you're gonna have to pay in the next year, and then below is your long-term portion of your long-term debt. So this is what we know you'll finance in the long term. So some things that I notice about this balance sheet is a potential cash crunch. So this construction company has, if you add in all of this, about $300,000 of payables that are gonna be due immediately. And he has $15,000 of cash. That's gonna present a problem when he goes to try and pay, because he doesn't have the funds to do it. Some other issues that this balance sheet would tell you is potentially an issue with slow payment on your accounts. So a lot of times people are so excited to make the sale, and then they're like, oh, I'll worry about billing and collecting later, because that's not the fun part. The fun part's making that sale. But the older your receivables are, the harder it is going to be to collect on them. So that's an important number to watch. So that's another issue. Are there some late receivables? Are there collection issues? Are there some ones that he's just not going to collect on because they've been sitting there for too long? Another issue that jumps out is the large work in progress. So for the size of what he's doing, that's a huge amount for him or her to invest and front without having any money come in just yet for it. And then new assets and corresponding new debt. So they're probably growing, they're needing to buy new equipment, they can't afford it, so they're having to finance it. So those are just some things that kind of jump out on that. Does anybody have any questions? Like, has anybody had to review or prepare a balance sheet before? Yeah. So it all kind of makes
sense. Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And does anybody have any other questions? Okay. So then the next one I'm going to look at is the income statement. So this is the one that the people are most comfortable with, because this is what's going to show you your sales and your expenses. So it's a financial report used to show the financial results for a period of time. So where the balance sheet is just a snapshot at a certain time, the income statement is going to be for a period of time. So either a year, a quarter, 6 months, however you decide you're going to report that. And there's some difference between, a lot of times people think, well, you know, I'm showing a lot of sales, how come I don't have any cash? So that's because of the way that your accounting has to be done. So it's called accrual accounting. And so those are those receivables, those payables, the deferred revenue, the work in progress. So net income does not mean cash inflow. So if you're buying inventory, that's cash going out that is not showing as an expense on your income statement. If you have deferred revenue, that's cash coming in that is not showing as revenue. Receivables are showing as revenue, but you haven't collected the cash on it yet. And payables are expenses that you haven't paid for yet. So there's, and then prepaids are cash that's gone out that the expense hasn't incurred yet. So when you look at your net income, it's important to realize that that's not going to match what your cash flow says. So this is a copy of your, this is an example of a statement of income. And so you've got your revenue on the top, and then you've got your cost of sales. So what your cost of sales are, it's costs specifically incurred to make the sale. So these are things like the purchase of your inventory, the wages specific to that sale. So if you have admin fees or management wages, that's, you'll see that that's under here. Subcontract, so if you have to hire subcontractors to do some of the work, that is directly involved with making that sale. So that's why it's split out separately. Because then what it gives you is your gross margin. So in this case, he has 490,000 gross margin, and he's making, so his gross margin percent is 28.8, which might be great depending on the industry. So if we said the industry average is 30, he's a little bit lower than average, but pretty close. But the other thing that concerns me is the trend. So last year, his gross margin was 36%. It's now dropped to 29. So then it's really important to know, okay, what happened? Are we not quoting properly? Have the costs of our purchases and our wages gone up, and we haven't corresponded, like we haven't increased our fees to correspond with those increases? So that's important to know, and that's important. That's part of the reason why you want to keep track of those, so you can correct that, where it's like, oh my gosh, my gross margin is dropping. I need to fix this before it becomes an issue. And then your expenses below your gross margin are the fixed costs. So these are things that presumably you don't really have a lot of control over, and you have to pay regardless of what's happening up here. So things like rent. You have to, your landlord doesn't care whether you're making a sale or not. They want their rent. Things like repairs and maintenance. If something breaks down, you're fixing it. So these are things that are they're not directly impacted by the sales. So then another observation that I have with this income statement is the management wages. So it's gone up a lot, which means management has decided to increase their wages, which might be fine, and maybe they hired an external manager to come in and do that. But it's one thing to watch, because if this individual is just starting to pull more money out, it might be a recommendation to, you need to slow down, you need to leave more reinvested in your company, because you're going to have a cash flow issue if you don't. Another number to point out is this amortization. So, and I apologize, I'm not sure what the financial level of everyone is, so I might be going into too much detail, and everyone maybe knows some of this stuff already, but amortization is sort of the using up of your capital assets. So if you buy a building, you're gonna be able to use that asset for several years, but buildings isn't a great example, because actually those usually will increase in value. Okay, so say you buy a vehicle. Every year, you're sort of using up that vehicle. So when you go to sell it after you've owned it for 5 years, you're not going to get what you paid for it because you've used it up. So that's what that amortization charge is it's an estimate of what you've used in your capital assets in the current year. And then you'll have your income before taxes, and then your tax number after that, so that you can kind of see, okay, before taxes, what did I make? What did I pay in income taxes? And then ultimately, what is the net income? And then this retained earnings, as I mentioned before, this is your equity. So this is what you've left in and reinvested in your company. And so the net income every year that you leave behind goes into that. And then the dividends paid is another form of management compensation. So as a shareholder, you can decide how you want to compensate yourself. So there you can do it through wages or through dividends. Wages, as you can see, are an expense and a deduction. deductible expense, so it decreases your income taxes. Dividends are an after-tax payout of equity. So you don't get a deduction in the company, but you do get preferential tax treatment on your personal tax return. Okay, so shareholder remuneration, sorry, so I kind of jumped ahead. So there's dividends versus wages. And some other things to consider is, well, tax deductibility I talked about, CPP benefit when you retire, dividends do not, it's not a pensionable income. So if you pay yourself dividends, you will not be remitting into CPP, which some people are like, absolutely, I don't want to pay into CPP because I don't think it'll be around when I go to retire. So then you probably would opt for a dividend. RRSP contribution room, same thing. It's not, wages create RRSP contribution room, dividends do not. So if you want to create that room, you'll have to do it as wages. Monthly remittances, some people will opt for dividends because if you do a wage, you have to remit your tax, CPP, EI, well not EI, but tax and CPP on a monthly basis to CRA, and some people say, I don't want to deal with having to worry about sending those in, so I'm just going to do a dividend. Flexibility with respect to income splitting. If you pay a wage out of your company, CRA says that it has to be reasonable based on the what the person getting paid is performing. Dividends, because it's an owner's draw, is just based on shareholdings. So say you have a spouse that you want to do some income splitting with, but they're not actively involved in the company. You can do it through dividends, assuming that they're a shareholder. Sorry. Does anybody have any questions so far? This is a lot of information, I know. Okay.
Oh, ma'am? Yeah. How do you find out the amortization rate for capital assets?
Well, the rule is that you're supposed to determine what the useful life is, and then apply it over that useful life. A lot of times what I recommend to small business owners is just use the CRA applied rates. So CRA has their own calculation of it. They're called CCA. And I can't remember what the acronym is a breakdown of, but they'll say, so like equipment, for example, they'll say 20% per year, and then buildings, they'll say 4% per year. So what I usually tell people is, rather than trying to go through and make that assessment, if you'd rather, you can just use the CRA prescribed rates. And then, yeah, it does depend on the class of assets.
If you're incorporated and you have a firm due year-end, they're probably, the accountant would go through the income statement and balance sheet with you. Is that common?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Your accountant at year end should be sitting down with you and going through your statements and making sure you understand what it's telling you. And they should give you some recommendations too, like if anything jumps out that they feel you should know about or be concerned about or course correct, that they should be pointing that out to you. And also the amortization, I think I maybe have one client that calculates their own amortization. It's generally something that the accountants will take care of. So as long as you keep your asset listing and you know what you've purchased, they'll calculate your amortization every year. So it's not something you generally have to worry about.
On a building, if you own a building, is there any advantage to using amortization for it, that 4%? When you sell, especially when you sell the building.
Well,
Know much about capital gains.
Yeah. That's a tax thing. So the confusing thing with amortization, more confusing thing about amortization, is that for tax and accounting, it's totally different. So there are the CRA prescribed rates, which go on your tax return, and then your amortization in your financial statements has nothing to do with your tax return. So on your tax return, you're not required to take their version of capital cost allowance. That's what the CCA stands for. You're not required to take it, so you don't have to. It just gives you a deduction every year. But if you know you're going to sell that building in the future at a gain, you may decide that you don't want to do it because, yes, you reduce your taxes today, but when you have that gain, it's actually a recapture, and you're taxed for whatever you've amortized over what you're able to sell it for. Because their thing is, if the CCA rate is appropriate, when you go to sell it, what's on that listing should be close to what you sell it for. But with buildings, it's different, right? Because actually appreciate. Yeah, so.
Yeah, sure.
Does that answer your question? Yeah. So the next statement is your cash flow statement. And another stat I read is that less than 10% of people understand their cash flow statement. So most people don't understand it. Most people don't even look at it. But it shows you where your cash has gone, and it shows you where you're generating cash, where you're spending cash. It's actually a very useful statement, but I do know that it's not terribly clear, so I'm going to go through it today. So this is a copy of your cash flow statement. This is what they'll look like. At the top, it starts with your net income, and then it's going to adjust out anything that's a non-cash item. So amortization is a non-cash expense. It doesn't hit you because you purchased that asset years and years ago. Then you've got your change in non-cash working items. So those are the things that say, okay, so your receivables, you haven't collected cash on that yet. Did they go up or down from last year? Because that's going to say whether you've invested cash in your AR or you've collected cash in your AR. So those type of things are taken into consideration. So one thing that's very important when you're looking at your cash flow, you don't need to go through all these numbers. This is the number that's important, because this is going to show you from your operations, did I make cash or did I lose cash? Because it's really important for companies to have this number positive. You can have a couple years where this is negative, but companies cannot sustain themselves long term if this balance is a negative for a long period of time. It just means that you're hemorrhaging cash, and from operations you can't kind of get ahead. And then you've got your cash flows from investing. So for a lot of businesses, this is just I'm investing in my business by buying equipment, by buying buildings, by buying land, those type of things. So you'll see there's a purchase of capital assets. And that's a negative because that's cash going out because you're paying for those items. And then financing. So this is actually an unusual circumstance because generally your cash flow from financing is going to also be a negative, which is why it's so important that your cash flows from operating is a positive, because usually investing and financing will be a negative. In this case, it's actually a positive because they've borrowed a lot of money this year. So it's a positive because that cash came in, but that's all money that's eventually going to have to be repaid. So next year, you won't have this cash coming in. You're just going to have a repayment of long-term debt. So this is going to go negative. And then here it just says, here's the net impact on cash. So they lost had more cash go out, $27,000 more cash go out than come in. So they started the year with $41,000 of cash. They ended the year with $15,000. So that's how you read it. And it does look really complicated when you look at it because there's so many numbers. But if you just focus on the main three, that's going to give you your information. And then key ratios. So there are a ton of financial ratios that you can track, and I put in everyone's package just a handout of all the different ratios. So I'm going to go through some key ones really quickly because they're not terribly exciting, I know, but they are important. So there's four common types of ratios. There's profitability, liquidity, asset management, and debt management. And then what's important with ratios is if you just look at one ratio, it's going to tell you nothing. What's important is looking for trends. So yes, that's where my number is today, but where was it yesterday? Where was it last year? Where was it the year before? And also knowing your industry benchmarks. So this is my number, but how does it compare with everybody else in my industry, in our area, those type of things. So profitability ratio is going to measure how well the business is performing and its ability to generate earnings compared to expenses. So generally, higher is better. Everybody wants to be more profitable. And some common ones are gross profit margin and return on equity. So I did kind of briefly touch on the gross profit margin because a lot of times it's right on the face of your balance sheet. But what it's calculating, it's taking your gross margin. So what do you have left over after you make your sale and you pay your cost of sales, divided by your sales. And then generally, higher is better, and it's measuring how much money you have left over from your revenue after your cost of goods sold. So if you're selling something and you're making $100, but it's costing you $105 to make it, you're not really ahead, and you're making nothing to help you contribute to your bottom line. So if we go to our example with our construction company, last year their gross margin was 36%. This year it's 29%. That means that this year there's 29 cents from every dollar of revenue earned left to cover their other expenses, which might be fine if that's the industry norm and last year was just unusually high, or that might be low. But if you compare it to last year, it seems like it's low. It seems like maybe something's happened that's resulted in the drop. So liquidity ratios, this is the degree to which an asset can be easily converted into cash. So higher means that you have less liquidity risk, but too high might indicate that you're not using your cash effectively. So if you have a balance sheet that has a ton of cash and you're not doing anything with it, you're probably missing opportunities. Maybe you could be buying better equipment. Maybe you could be hiring another sales guy. Maybe you could be investing, those type of things. So if you have too much cash on your balance sheet, you're probably not really taking advantage of all the opportunities to you. So you don't want it to be too high. And then common ones are working capital and current ratio. So your working capital is just basically how much money am I going to have to work with over the next year. So it takes your current assets and your current liabilities. So in our example again, this year he will have $105,000 to work with next year, presumably based on the balance sheet at year end date. And last year he only had 40. So that, by just looking at the 2 years, shows that he has improved his cash situation from last year, assuming that he's going to be able to liquidate the inventory and the work in progress and collect on all the receivables. Asset management ratios. So this measures how effectively you're using your assets in your business. So frequent ratios are days sales in receivables and days sales in inventory. So days sales and accounts receivable, this tells you how many days it takes on average to collect your receivables. So generally lower is better, because you want to be turning those receivables over really quickly, because that means that you don't have your money invested in your receivables. If you have a really high days sales and receivables, so if it's taking your clients 120 days on average to pay their bills, then maybe you need to work on your collection policies. Maybe you need to be sending out progress bills or billing quicker. Maybe you need to be sending notices. Maybe you need to charge an interest or penalty fee for anybody who's late. What the point there is, don't finance your customers interest-free, because nobody's going to finance you interest-free.
Yeah, so when you're charging interest, is there a standard, or can you just pull a number out of your...
There's no standard.
And so what happens with that? So, for example, so if a client didn't pay, so you're running on like 6 months. And then so now I decide, can I now decide to put interest on it? Or does that just have to be like something that's right from the start, it shows on all their invoices at the bottom?
Yeah.
If it's over, or how does that work?
You kind of have to have it set out. Sorry. Go ahead. Did you want to...
No, whenever you were finished.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you kind of need to set that out ahead of time. So when you're making those sales, like when you send out that first initial invoice, so like I know when we send out invoices, we have something on the bottom that says our collection term is 30. I actually don't know what ours says exactly, but it's like 30 days or we will pay a 3%, or we'll charge a 3% fine per month. So you kind of have to have it on there. I don't know that after it's been outstanding for so long, you could go and be like, now I'm going to charge you interest, because the client's probably going to be like, I'm not paying that. Mm-hmm. So, go ahead.
Out of experience, we noticed that the penalties are actually never honored. They'll pay the bottom line, but they won't pay the penalties. And it's like you're beating a dead horse.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You're lucky to get principal.
Yeah, and you do have to decide how hard you want to go after. Like, if they pay the principal amount, do you really want to go after the interest charge? And maybe
no.
Yeah, and so
we just have to... Yeah,
we
just adjusted our rates for certain customers.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's totally company policy or business policy how you want to do that. Or even if you want to do that, It's just an idea. If you think that it might encourage quicker payment, then it's nice to have it on there. If you don't have any interest, then yeah, if you have a customer that's cash poor, they might be like, well, I'm going to pay these bills first because I'm going to be paying interest and penalties.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to pay these guys last because they're not charging me anything.
So in finance especially, a lot of times it's easier to do stuff like that with a carrot than a stick. So they'll use net contracts that says, hey, if you're having a problem with receivables and your people aren't paying for 120 days, then you can say, if you pay within 30, I'll give you a 5% discount on what the receivable is. And typically, especially if they're in a cash crunch, the person is more willing to pay at a discount for the services they've already rendered than to pay somewhere else. So that's something that you can kind of take a look at if it gets kind of out of line as well.
Yeah. And in a face-to-face community too, like usually people are supposed to pay within 30 days, but like if somebody doesn't, I worked for a lawyer and I was his litigation assistant, and if it go on 2 months, I would start to make phone calls for him, or if I thought the person was never going to pay, I would tell my boss, you know, you should get, what is that called, that they pay ahead of time?
Oh, a retainer.
A retainer, because I don't know if you're allowed to do that if you're not a lawyer, to get a retainer. You are? Anybody can get a retainer?
It's just a deposit. Sure. You know, before I do the service, it's the same as the photographer example that I said, where it's like, if I'm booking for a wedding and I'm going to make them pay $5,000 up front.
Yeah, that's what you said. Yeah, that's a retainer.
Yeah, same idea.
So you're allowed
idea.
To do that if you think somebody, like, would rather go to eat than pay their bill.
Well,
No. It's so funny because, like, if they don't pay their bill and then you see them in a restaurant and they're, like, ordering certain stuff and they're, like, giving you money and, like, you just want to lunge across.
Yeah.
You're going to, like, drive yourself crazy if you think that way.
Yeah,
a bit of a bookkeeping question, but when I have somebody that owes interest now, I don't invoice them for the interest. Is that something that just, hey,
you do the statement, so you should be regularly sending them statements like, by the way, you still owe us money, because you don't want people forgetting that they owe you, right? So what I would do is send out regular statements and tack on that interest so that they can see it growing and hopefully encourages them to come in and pay. Some people are just not going.
Well, it's true, like any like big companies that I deal with too. Like you'll get a small business, you will pay, but if you're dealing with Coca-Cola or any like big, it's always 3 months, 9 days. They won't even, like, I'm like,
they don't have any feelings. They,
no.
they actually pay accountants to figure out how much they're going to save by not paying you for 90 days.
Well, and some of that I think too is just their administration is so huge that it just
takes that long
to get through the system.
Mm-hmm.
So
I was doing a research contract and the person wasn't going to pay me, my client, so I invited her to have lunch with me and a senior person we had a mutual business contact with. So anyway, I got paid before the lunch happened.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, so sometimes you just have to get
sometimes
creative.
Sometimes you just have to shame.
Shame is powerful to them.
So, sorry, was there any other questions?
Shame is a powerful.
So, and this is how to calculate that day's sales and receivables. And this is in your notes, and that's also in your handout. So, in our example, this year it took him, on average, 36 days to collect, whereas last year it was 22. So, especially when you're growing and you need that money, you don't want to see your day's sale and receivables slide. Because you're financing your client and you've got cash tied up in those receivables. So yeah, to try and be like, okay, well, what happened? Why is it slower to pay? Am I now dealing with oil and gas firms who are really slow to pay? Or is there something that I can be doing to speed that up? Day sales and inventory is very similar. It tells you how many days it takes for you on average to sell your inventory. So again, generally lower is better, but what you don't want to do is have it so low that you're missing sale opportunities because you don't have the inventory on hand. So it is kind of a fine line. You don't want to have so much inventory that it risks going obsolete, that you've got a ton of your capital tied up in that inventory where you're having a hard time meeting financial obligations because you've got all this cash tied up. But at the same time, if it's so low and people are like, well, I'm going to go to your competition because you can't meet my needs right now because you don't have the inventory on hand, that's not good either. And so this is our example again. So this year, it took him close to 77 days to turn over his inventory, whereas last year was 20. So again, maybe in his industry, 77 days is normal and 19 was too low. that's where those industry norms really come into play. That's when knowing what your benchmarks are, how you've done, and it's hard even just to look at 2 years. 2 years is really not enough. You should really be looking at, I usually look at 5 years if possible, because that's going to give you a good picture of what the trend is. And then the last type of ratios is your debt management ratio. So this measures the extent the company is financed through debt versus financing it through yourself. These ratios will help you see early signs of solvency problems and assess risk of default. And then the common ones are debt to equity and debt service ratio. So debt to equity measures the company's financial risk, and a higher ratio means more risk. So banks will almost always look at this number. If it's too high, they're like, no, I'm not giving you any more money. You have too much debt and you're not invested enough in this company yourself. So this is an important ratio to watch. So our example again this year, his debt to equity ratio went from 1:1 to 2:1, which means that for every dollar of equity, so for every dollar he has invested in his company, the bank has invested 2. And then at that point, banks will start to get nervous because they're like, we have more invested in this company than you do, and we're going to be really reluctant to give you more financing. We're probably not going to give you preferential interest rates. Our restrictions might be more rigid, we might require higher personal guarantees, all that kind of stuff. So that's an important ratio to know. So speaking of the bank, a lot of banks, when you get financing, will have their own covenants. So they'll have their own 2 to 3 ratios that they want you to meet. And if you don't meet it, they can call the loan. So it's very important when you're getting any sort of financing that you understand what those ratios are and you track them to make sure that you're not offside. A lot of banks are reasonable if you can prove that you're going to get them back onside. A lot of times they won't call the debt, but the risk is that they can say, you know what, you're not meeting this financial covenant that we've put in place, so we're going to require payment right away. The last topic, I think it's my last topic. Oh no, maybe not. Budgeting. So budgeting is another financial thing that I know people dread. And I know when you think of budgeting, you think of penny pinching and depriving myself and not being able to do what I want to do. But really what it is it's about looking forward and trying to predict the final financial aspect of possible actions. So you kind of look at, like, what if? So what if I make this in sales? What if I make this in sales? What if I buy this piece of equipment? Is it going to increase? What if I hire that sales manager? Am I going to increase my sales or am I not going to increase my sales? And then having a look at that, and where people will almost automatically think of penny pinching, sometimes it actually gives you some financial freedom, because if you're always going based on gut, so maybe this opportunity will present itself and it's a really great advertising opportunity or a really great piece of equipment, and your gut says, you know what, I don't think I can afford this, I'm not going to go for it. The budget, if you had done a budget, might say, yeah, you have the ability to do this, go for it. So sometimes it actually gives you the freedom to feel like you can make some of those financial decisions. And then specific budgeting with regards to job costing. So depending on what industry you work in, so our example has been construction. So job costing is very important in construction, but it's very important in a lot of industries. When you're preparing bids or quoting for specific jobs, you want to be able to quote in a way that you know at the end of that job you're going to have made money. So we have one company that we work with, and they had quoted a job, and they on one of their pretty big jobs they had actually forgotten to include floors. That's a huge expense, and you can't build a building without floors, so they lost their shirts on that job. So if they had a better job costing system in place, that probably wouldn't have happened, and they probably would have had a better year. So what you want to do is think, okay, how much is this going to cost me, and work backwards. Know what your contribution margin is. So your contribution is the same as your gross margin. So what do I want to have left over after all of my variable costs? And a lot of people confuse your gross margin with your markup. It's not your markup. So find out what you want after that, and then calculate what your markup is on that. And then remember that you can't do this as a break even either, because you still need to cover your costs. So things like rent, utilities, your management and your administration, your legal and your accounting. Those are still things that need to be covered. So if you're not kind of including enough that at the end of the year you're going to be able to cover those, you're going to have lost money. So,
what's the difference between, what was that, gross margin and markup?
Markup, yeah. So markup is taking your costs and adding a percentage. Your gross margin is after you take your revenue minus your expenses, and then like it gives you kind of a number there. You divide that by your sales, and then that's your gross margin. So it doesn't work out to the same percent, but a lot of people think that it does. So so that causes some confusion. So break even. So as I was mentioning, you'll want to know what your break even amount is. And I don't mean break even per job. I mean break even at the end of the year. So what revenue do you have to earn to cover all of your fixed costs and your variable costs so that you end the year not in a loss position? And then any sales after that break even point are going to mean profits. So that's an important number to know, because if you sort of have an idea of what that target is, then you'll have an idea before you even see your financials. Did I make money this year or did I lose money this year? Yeah.
If you have different revenue streams and then you do gross margin for each one and then average revenue?
Yeah, like on your financial statements, it'll just do gross margin on a total. So it'll take your total revenues, your total cost of sales, and then it'll give you your total gross margin. But it is very, if you have, like you said, different revenue streams, it is very important to know what your gross margin is for every revenue stream, because a lot of companies don't do that analysis. And then they'll find out that the one is basically floating all the other ones, and they should really be focusing their effort on that stream instead of the others. So on your financial statements, it'll just be in a total, but it is good to do that analysis as well and know from each stream what you're earning to see where you should kind of focus your efforts and or see if there's a problem child that you maybe need to either decide, like, do I want to stay in this area or do I just need to improve it? So, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Does anybody have any other questions? So this is how to calculate break even. I won't try and run through it or go through the formula is here. So if you want to try and calculate it out, which I do recommend trying to calculate it out, and it'll be rough because you're not going to know exactly what your fixed costs are or exactly what your cost of sales are, but it'll give you an idea. And then what you can do in the formula is add your desired level of profit too. To determine what level of sales you need to make the profit that you want to make as well. So key performance indicators, a lot of times will be ratios, but they don't necessarily have to be. What they are things that you can quantifiably measure that you have to get right to make sure that your business is successful. So what I always say is pick 3 to 5, because if you pick more than that, it's just going to be too much. You're either not going to really want to calculate them or they're not going to mean a lot. So if you say, these are the 3 to 5 things that I absolutely need to get right to succeed, and then figure out what you need to track to do that. So it might be a financial ratio. It might be like, you know what, I need to be quickly turning over those receivables so I have cash flow to reinvest in my business. So maybe you're going to track your days sales and receivables. Or maybe you say, you know what, it's going to be repeat customers. I need to make sure that I have loyal customers. So that's not going to tie into your financial statements. That's something that you'd have to track kind of outside of your financials. But maybe that's what's important, and maybe that's what you need to track. So, you know, as much as when I do KPIs, I usually will default to ratios because that's what I'm comfortable with and that's what I understand. That is not always the indicator of how well you're going to do depending on your business. And it's going to be very specific to what you do. And even companies that are the same, presumably, or look the same from the outside, might have totally different end goals. So I have one client who does not want to grow. He's very comfortable with the size that he is. He's very comfortable with the level of employees he has. He wants to sustain where he's at. He wants to have good relationship with the customer. And then I have another client who's the exact same industry, exact same type of business, and he wants to grow, he wants to get bigger, he wants to hire people. So their KPIs, even though from the outside they look like the same company, are going to be totally different because their goals are totally different. So both financial and non-financial. So it might be a ratio. Non-financial might be employee turnover, new customers, repeat customers, customer satisfaction, those type of things. It has to be something that you can measure, though, because otherwise it doesn't really work. You're just going again by gut. So. And then factors that will increase your profit. So I think I have two similar slides. Okay, I'm going to skip that because it's sort of the four ways to grow. So a lot of times what I see with new business owners or entrepreneurs is that they have so many ideas that it's really hard for them to really focus on one idea. And so four ways to grow your business is sort of an idea that there's really only four ways to grow. And then there might be infinite options under the four ways, but there's really only four. So what we'll do with clients a lot of times is just start brainstorming ideas under the different categories. So for example, increase the number of customers of the type you want. And always make sure to say of the type you want, because you don't want high maintenance clients or customers who are coming in and yelling at you, who never pay their bill, who argue about your service fees, who don't appreciate what you do. We all want more clients and more customers, but if they're a problem child, that's not the type you want. So by trying to reach out and cast a wide net and catch everyone, you know, you might grow, but sometimes those customers cost more than they actually bring in. So that's why I always say of the type you want. And so ideas there could be your advertising or your marketing plan. Reducing prices will a lot of times increase your customers, and maybe that's a good strategy and maybe it's not. Partnerships or joint ventures. So, you know, I'll pair up with you because you have a similar business, and then we'll share clients and we can increase our clients that way, that kind of stuff. Does anybody have any other ideas with increasing the number of customers that you can do?
Referrals?
Yeah. Ask your customers that you know are good customers to give you referrals. And I mean, when you give somebody a referral, you're putting your own name on. So they're not going to refer you people that they think are not going to be good customers. So that's a good one for sure.
Kind of a flip on what you said. And I don't know if I've used this example before, but it's all about knowing your clients. Grey Goose Vodka is a great example of a vodka that was released at a dirt cheap price because that's what they thought their people wanted. They had no sales. And then they increased their price and they sold out because people had a perceived value in the price and that was what their demographic wanted.
Yeah, interesting. So the other one is to increase the number of times your customer comes back. So this is getting those people back in the door. So not having just one-time customers, but how can we make them loyal and continue on? So some things like that might be loyalty programs. So I'll have a punch card, and once you make 10, you'll get a free sandwich or something like that. Or just having really excellent customer service. And what does that mean? Again, that goes back to knowing the type of customer that you want, knowing what type of customer service that they want. When people go to Walmart, they know that you're not going to find somebody if you need somebody. You know that the customer service is that level, but you go there because of the prices. Whereas if you go somewhere more boutique, you're going there because you want that individual customer service, you want to be doted on a little bit, that type of thing, but you know you're going to pay more. So to increase the number of time your customers come back, you need to know what they actually want. And a lot of times we make assumptions about what our customers or our clients want, and that's not always the right thing. Like Grey Goose, assuming that they wanted cheap vodka, and really they wanted just good vodka, and they were willing to pay more. Does anybody have any other ideas that could fit under that one?
Introduce a new product.
Yeah, and that could work with the first one too. Like to get new customers, maybe you need a new product. Yeah, so it could fit in either of those for sure. Did you have one?
Oh, just not to underestimate the value of your own business, because I think that like that's true. If something's more valuable, if it seems more unique, like not something outrageously priced, but I think I hear a lot of great business ideas, and then I'm like, why are you selling yourself so short? Because this is real value for the market economy. So that's what I think is like really understand your target audience, I think, and know what to charge, what would be fair for the value of your contribution.
Yeah. And there are a lot of people, like a lot of times we assume to grow, we've got to cut costs and cut prices and stuff like that. But I mean, for a lot of people, they'd be willing to pay more if what they're getting is more quality.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's important to know. And then the next one is to increase the average value of each sale. So how can I make more every time somebody comes in the door? And the obvious one is increased price. So where we talked about decreasing price, depending on your customer base, depending on your business, depending on what your strategy is, cutting price might be your strategy, increasing price might be your strategy. And so I see a lot of times with business owners is they are so busy that they can't handle, like they don't have the capacity to handle the sales that they're making, and they're having more and more demand on their time. And so a lot of times it's like, I just can't do more, my guys can't do more. And so a lot of times what I'll say to them is, well, when's the last time you increased your price? Well, I can't increase my price, my customers won't pay it. And it's like, well, you might lose the really price sensitive one, but you're already having a hard time keeping up with your volume. So maybe losing the ones that are really price conscious is not a bad thing. If you can focus on the 90% that are willing to pay more, you can actually increase your revenue and work a little bit less. So that's an important thing to realize, because a lot of times people get and they're so busy and they just don't know how to handle it, and maybe losing some customers isn't the end of the world if it's the bottom, your D customers. So
depending on like what industry you're into, like for me, for example, like I can farm some of my work out and be the middleman and make money. It may not be what I could do on my own, but I'm still making money and having the product delivered in a time efficient manner, and no stress and no wear and tear on my own machinery. But I guess
totally depends on the industry, but there are a lot of industries where you can't subcontract,
right? It's just a lot easier. It's like people think, like with us for instance, around Christmas time, we're stupid busy, like so busy where everyone's working like 18 hours a day. It's retarded. And why? For what?
Yeah.
Sub it out, and then it's better on your mental health.
Yeah,
too.
And you're right. You're maybe not getting the same margin that you would if you did it yourself. But
people are happy, though.
Yeah, exactly.
Because their product is being delivered on time.
Yeah,
right.
And you're happier because you're not wearing yourself out.
Yeah, for sure.
Exactly. Another thing is to bundle or upsell. So are there two products that go really well together? Can you try it? McDonald's is great at this, right? Like, do you want fries with that? Would you like to upsize? Like, that's exactly what they're doing. They're increasing the average value of each sale. So that's sort of their strategy. And then the last one is increase the effectiveness of each process in the business. So this is where it comes to cost cutting. So a lot of times when I talk to business owners, that's their immediate thing is, I gotta cut costs, like I need to make more money, I gotta cut costs, I gotta fire somebody, I gotta decrease how much this is costing me, I gotta cut back on my materials. But if you notice, in the four ways, three of them have to do with sales, one of them has to do with processes. So maybe you do have some inefficiencies, maybe you do have some waste where you can cut those costs. But a lot of times what I see is business owners cut to where they can't do anything extra, they can't properly promote their product, they can't advertise because they've cut to the point where they've given themselves no room to do that. So yes, it is on here, and it is important to be efficient, and it is important to make sure you're not being wasteful or having unnecessary costs, but at the same time, it's really sales that drive everything. So that's kind of an important thing there. And then with this, so this might be regular bills and collection policies. This could be job costing and quoting. This could be changing vendors or volume pricing, paying on time to get the discount, paying on time. I had one client who, we did this exercise, and he was in a break-even position every year. Like, he paid himself a wage, so he was happy, but the company was never had anything at the end of the day. And we looked at some things, and we talked about his cost of materials. And he hadn't talked to his vendor in years. He just used the same vendor forever. And I was like, well, if you talk to this person, how much do you think you can get maybe off as a discount or a reduced price? And he said, you know, I can probably negotiate 2%. And a lot of times right there, people are like, is it worth the hassle for 2%? Well, in 1 year, he went from break even to making $80,000 in his company. So 2% made a huge difference, and that's 1 year. So if he can keep that up, that compounds, right? So that's the other thing that's maybe important to say is, like, don't underestimate how much of an impact a small change can be. So I've seen clients who haven't increased their prices for a really long time and then are worried that they can't. And it's like, well, would your customers even notice if you increased your price by 5%? Well, probably not. Maybe a few would, but most wouldn't. And that can have a huge impact on your bottom line. So, yeah, never underestimate how some of those small things can make a huge impact. Does anybody have any other?
I was thinking like another way to maybe to grow is getting feedback from your customer. Because sometimes you're missing something, you don't get that information from your customer, and you can
network
from that, grow from that.
Yeah, I think that is absolutely right. I think we don't ask our customers or our clients enough. How are we doing? What would you like to see? What are we? Because we assume we know what they want. We have an awesome product. How could this not be exactly what they want? But you know, it may be not. So how do we know that without asking them? And a lot of times, it's even just a quick phone conversation.
Your follow up is so huge.
Yeah.
Follow up is just so big.
Yeah,
people
and
don't understand like how, and well, depending on what industry you're into.
Yeah,
but it's crazy. Like,
and it allows you to course correct too.
Well, for sure.
So you can fix, you can nip that problem in the bud versus letting it compound and then having people leave and be like, well, how come you're leaving? I'm like, well, I don't like this. Like, how come you didn't tell me? But a lot of times, unless you are the one to have that to start that conversation, they won't tell you. They'll just leave. So, I'm sorry. What was your Oh, networking, yeah.
Yeah, and just to add to his proposal.
Yeah.
You
yeah,
know, you can network with your customers just as good as with the business community that you're in.
Yeah, definitely. I think networking is incredibly important because I think Lethbridge has still got a lot of small town feel to it, and a lot of work is word of mouth and referrals and knowing people in the community. So I think it's very important to have a good network in Lethbridge.
I think one way you can increase your profits too is by how you spend your labor money. For example, if you are a plumber and you're taking time off to run, if you're rural, to run to Lethbridge to get parts, well, you could be using your time more effectively by hiring somebody to run to Lethbridge to get parts for you while you are doing the actual plumbing.
Yeah, absolutely. Delegation is huge. Like
construction. If you're putting in journeyman carpenter to clean up the scraps, you're not using very wise labor.
That's an economic theory called opportunity cost. And it's the reason that if you're a lawyer that makes $300 an hour, ask Stephen Mogden about that next week. If you pay someone $15 an hour to mow your lawn, you're not just paying them $15 an hour because you're a lawyer who can make $300 an hour. So you mowing your lawn is actually a way bigger cost than you just paying someone to do it.
Yeah. And I heard at the beginning of the class that last week you had been challenged to track your time for 2 weeks. And I think that is an incredibly valuable exercise. And I know I've done it. It's painful. It is to try and track every 15 minutes of your day. I mean, I have to do it at work because that's how we bill. But, you know, to do it on your personal time as well is painful. But it's amazing what you can learn about yourself and where you're wasting time. Mm-hmm. So it's not just about tracking the time. It's about going in afterwards and saying, what am I doing that's important? What am I doing? Has anybody read Stephen Covey's The 7 Habits of Highly Successful? Yeah. So in there is that time metrics that says everything is broken into importance and urgency. So it says, you know, track your time and then decide, was what I just did important and was it urgent? And a lot of times you'll find that you're either dealing with things that are urgent that you thought at the time were important, but because it, urgency masks as important, you're like, oh my gosh, I have to send this email because somebody emailed me. And then later you look back and you're like, that probably could have waited. That wasn't that important. Or things that we're doing that are just busy work. And that goes to your point, like driving into Lethbridge for parts is not important. And I mean, it might be important and urgent, I guess, if the job needs it now. But is it important and urgent for him to do it? Probably not. So, yeah. So I mean, I don't think very many people did it, but I would recommend doing it. You'll it's an eye opener. You'll learn a lot about yourself.
If you track the time, you can kind of keep track of your cost per customer as well. How much time, you know, you pay the person who pays you, but if you're going to spend 4 hours with a guy who's paying you $20 an hour, you're making really $5.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm. Yeah. Exactly. So I had a guy who sort of worked in kind of technology, and he was doing website upkeep for people. But if they had quick questions or something that didn't take that long, he wouldn't bill them for that. So I was like, but if you add up how much of your day you're spending doing that and you're not billing any of it, that can add up. So yeah, definitely knowing if you're actually making money on certain customers or not.
So what would you bill that under then? Like, how could you put that? Just follow up,
him, that was part of his contract.
No, but yeah, but so in general. So say I deal, so I'm back and forth with a client 30 times a day because they can't make up their mind.
Yeah.
And I'm resending stuff over and over and over. Well, it's really time consuming because I do it all the time.
Yeah.
So how can you, like, what would you?
I think in that case, maybe you change the way you bill for that specific. So if you're already in the middle of a contract or an agreement, you probably can't change it at that point. But then when they come back, be like, okay, I know you're high maintenance.
Yeah,
I know I've been charging you this amount, but my fee is going up to this amount.
But what would you put that under? Like, so what I'm saying is, like, okay.
I would try consultation.
Fees.
Because I got shafted for consultation because I phoned my accountant. And I talked to him for 15 minutes, and I got a $150 bill in the mail. And then a month later, he phones me, wondering whether he should bring in the barbecue to get it fixed or not, and asked him, is it a Canadian Tire barbecue or is it a $2,000 barbecue? He says, it's a Canadian Tire barbecue. I said, throw it away.
And I'll send you a bill.
That was my weak point. I thought about it, but I didn't do it. I should have sent him $150 or $175 bill for phone consultation.
Well, we take for granted our time.
Yeah, we do.
We don't waste, but we don't. Our time is important too. If you're self-employed, you only get 24 in a day.
It depends.
And it's usually not enough, right?
Yeah.
So
it depends what industry you're in, though. Like my wife and I, we haven't owned a machine shop, and quite often I had customers, good loyal customers, they would phone me and say, hey, Jesus, can you come have a look at this? And so I would go over, and I kind of tracked my time, but obviously I wasn't as, you know, as you guys were saying about tracking your time. But I would offset that time onto the job that I possibly was going to walk home with, or drive home with. And, some of it was just, you know, it kind of makes a relationship too, right?
Yeah.
Well, with a high maintenance client, I think what you should do is just say, you know what, I really appreciate your business, but I have to be able to plan my days. So every time you call me for a minute, it's going to cost you so much money.
No, well, I can't.
No, but to have boundaries, with this person, right? Like, I'm so excited that Stephen Mogden is coming here next week because he's my corporate lawyer, even though I'm new to start, but I've known him for years. And then so if I call him about something, I say, can you please tell me how much this will cost me before I start to talk? Because I need to budget, right? But he's very fair.
Yeah, he's really good.
He's really good.
Yeah.
But I like that when you speak with a professional, you have to ask them, well, how much is this going to cost me? You have to budget that cost.
Yeah, and I mean, and every professional bills differently. Like,
yeah.
I know, like, a lot of times if we have a quick 5-minute phone call, we don't bill for that. It's just part of our year-end fee. Like, we don't necessarily track that or bill. But if it's longer, like, if we have to do a bunch of research, then yes, we will. But yeah, and sometimes professionals aren't good at knowing tell, like, by the way, this will probably be a X number of fees. So it is a good policy to just ask, so that there's no surprises at the end, because that is the worst. So I have to wrap up because I'm out of time. So part of this whole financial thing is just to know that you can only manage what you measure. So if you don't know where your financials are at, how can you manage that? Because again, it goes back to, I'm making decisions based on my gut because I don't really know. Timely information is important. If you're looking at financial statements for your year end and it's 6 months past your year end, any sort of useful information, it's still useful. You can still make changes if you need to make changes, but you are now 6 months late, a year late. You could have made those changes a lot earlier if you knew what they needed to be before that. Plan to start doing the right things. Don't leave things to fate. Take time to work on your business, not just in it. So that's tough because, again, it goes back to, I only have so many hours in the day. All of this stuff needs to get done. My business planning, strategizing, looking at my financials, that's all stuff that doesn't have a deadline, so it's easy to push off. But that's the really important stuff, and that's what's really going to make a difference in your business. And then it's so important to talk to your professionals, and I know I'm a professional, so I'm probably a little biased, but I see so many people who come in after the fact who have absolute disasters, and I promise you it costs way more to fix than to do it right the first time. So if you're setting up a corporation, talk to a lawyer and have it set up right the first time, because again, it's a huge hassle and a huge expense to try and fix it afterwards if it isn't set up correctly. Same thing with your financials. If you bring in a shoebox of receipts 2 years after your year end was supposed to be filed, you're paying a fortune to have somebody put that together. By the time you get the information, it's not valuable. You're paying penalties and interest because everything's late. Your bank's on top of you to try and get the numbers. So, you know, it's just important to really have that partnership. Same with your bankers or anybody that you're working with. Make sure you have those relationships where you feel like you can call them and ask them questions, and you might have to ask them if they're going to bill you for it, but it's better to know those things and less costly to know those things initially than after it's too late. So thank you so much for letting me come.